Keeping Quiet, composed by Pablo Neruda. So here is a poem which poet Pablo Neruda is the pen name of Natfil Ricardo Reis, who was born in the town of Parral in Chile. His poems are full of easily understood images which make them no less beautiful. So he won the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1971. So here he talks about the necessity of quiet introspection and creating a feeling of mutual understanding among human beings. So from this much of, you know, summed up ideas about the poem, we come to know about the poem that it's about a quiet introspection. So remember this. So it's about quiet introspection. Right? Basically, the poem is about the importance of self-analysis. Okay? Introspection. Introspection is when you make out what is right, what is wrong, what you are doing, why are you doing it, whether it is okay or not. If not, analysis will tell you to leave that and to start with something which is good or correct. So in a way, self-introspection is about stopping, thinking, and redoing with renewed zeal. Okay, whenever we do something, what happens? Whenever we get something to do, what happens usually? We first think like why we should do it. We also think like should we do it or not? If yes, then why? If no, then what would be the consequences? Whatever the resultant answers you get, you do accordingly. That is analysis. That is about thinking and doing. But what usually happens many a times, because of the rush of activities, because of the over busy schedule, we don't think. We just keep on doing something or certain things without realizing whether they are of any use for us or not. Okay? So what makes us do without thinking? What makes us do certain things without thinking? Charanjot, yes? Yes, when we are in a hurry. When are we in a hurry? When we are getting late. When do we get late? When we are in a hurry and when we are getting late, when there is pressure. And when is the pressure there? When there are so many things to do at one time. When we've got to do so many things at one time, then we feel stressed. Out of stress, we don't think. Without thinking, the actions are always without positive result. And the poet is here with a suggestion that in case you get that kind of situation, when you are overstressed, when there is, when that time, when you feel like there is a lot of pressure upon you, when you don't have time to see what is to be done and what is not to be done, then at that time, take a break. Stop for 12 seconds. Stop, take a break, close your eyes, and then think. At that time, number one, the poet says, stop doing everything else. Means don't move physically at all. Number two, don't speak anything. Number one, don't speak. Number two, don't move, yes. So number one, don't speak. Number two, don't move. Right? But what to do? Think. It's not that you go to sleep then. You think. Don't move. Don't speak. Just think. And what to think? Think about the, about what is to be done and what is not to be done. Think about, like, if you're doing something, is it of any use? If it's of no use, leave it. If it is of some use, you can see how can you do it better. Okay, for example, you are, you know, nowadays you are stressed up. You have got your schools, you've got your tuitions, you've got your phones, you've got your social networking, you've got your social, you know, pressure. You have to answer the chats and all. So many things. You take a break. Wait, introspect for about 10 minutes or 5 minutes. Jot down the things you are doing, number one. Then start crossing out the things you think are irrelevant. And when you will crossing out, when you'll be crossing out the irrelevant things, what will happen? You will find that in the end, there are hardly two or three things you need to do. Rest of the seven things were useless, you will find out. Okay, you can do this exercise after this. When you go home, do this. Only 10 minutes. Write down the things you are very busy with. Then you cross out the things without which you can do absolutely well. If you are able to make 10 things, out of 10, you will see 7 or 6 things are absolutely useless. So how many would be left to do? 4. 3 or 4. Or at maximum 5. Then there you see, like, what is the number one thing to be done? What should be your priority? What should be the priority? Circle that. And then you see why it should be your priority. Write down the answers, whatever come to your mind. It will give you your good weightage, good marks, or good health, good peace of mind. So whatever answer you're getting, write that. And second priority, third priority. Then finally you see, like, out of this, which one is getting the maximum weightage, that you encircle in bolder terms than the other things. Finally, the answer will be with you, like, what should be done with 100%, you know, attention. And why answer also you will get. And then when you will start, you will see that there is no confusion. You will see that you'll be able to start that work and do that work with more zeal, enthusiasm, passion. And when you do something with passion, the results are always awesome. Many a times you people might be complaining ki bahut padhte hain ma'am, bahut mehnat kar rahe hain, but we are not getting that. Usually 70% children or parents say the same thing. Like, we do best, but results nahi itne aa rahe. The reason is that we are lacking somewhere that passion. Passion is lacking because we are not single-minded. We are not single-minded because we are stressed up. We are stressed up because we've got so many things to do. We've got so many things to do because we have never given a thought to what is to be done. We keep on doing. We keep on doing everything, whatever comes our way. And then in the end, result is average. And sometimes below average. It's never excellent. So this poem is an answer to all these kinds of problems. So let's first of all go through this poem. Let's see what is written in this poem. Then we'll see, like, how is this poem relevant to us? Okay, and how is this poem, is it relevant only to us? Or is it relevant to the whole world? And you will see both ways. It is relevant to us as person also, and it is relevant to the whole universe, whole world, each and every person. Maybe the prime minister, maybe the president of the world, or maybe the common citizen like me or you. Okay, let's see. So just the reading first. So keeping quiet. Now we'll count to 12 and we'll all keep still. for once on the face of the earth, let's not speak in any language. Let's stop for 1 second and not move our arms so much. It would be an exotic moment without rush, without engines. We would all be together in a sudden strangeness. Fishermen in the cold sea would not harm whales, and the man gathering salt would look at his hurt hands. Those who prepare green wars, wars with gas or wars with fire, victory with no survivors, would put on clean clothes and walk about with their brothers in the shade doing nothing. What I want should not be confused with total inactivity. Life is what it is about. I want no truck with death. If we were not so single-minded about keeping our lives moving and for once could do nothing, perhaps a huge silence might interrupt this sadness of never-ending understanding, of never understanding ourselves and of threatening ourselves with death. Perhaps the earth can teach us, as when everything seems dead and later proves to be alive. Now I'll count up to 12 and you all keep quiet and be, and I will go. Got it? So here in the end, the poet says, okay, now I'll go. I'll count up to 12 and you people become quiet and I'm going. So the point is, the poet has left it upon us to introspect. So he has told us the importance of keeping quiet, introspection. Okay, first of all, now before we start discussing the poem in detail, line to line, first of all, we need to understand, like, what is the problem? Like, what's the main root of the problems? I'm repeating the lines from here and then you make out, like, what's the root of the problems? Listen carefully. If we were not so single-minded about keeping our lives moving, if we were not so single-minded about keeping our lives moving and for once could do nothing, perhaps a huge silence might interrupt this sadness of never understanding ourselves and of threatening ourselves with death. The root of the problem is that we don't understand ourselves. We don't understand ourselves. What does it mean? We don't even know, like, what is good for us and what is bad for us. Isn't it right? If we knew this, then would we be doing doing the things which are disastrous for us? For example, going after social networking sites. Going so social, is that good for us? Especially you students? No, but even then it is the students only who are there in the social life maximum. The children where they need maximum concentration and focus, they only are in the social media. They cannot do without chatting or whatever, right? If I'm saying something right now, there might be many sitting over there who might be chatting side by side. No, they might be commenting about what I'm saying here. Is that the requirement? That is not the requirement, because we don't understand ourselves. We don't know what is good for us, what is bad for us. This is the root of problems with we human beings right now. We don't understand ourselves. We don't know what is good for us for good health. If we knew, then would we go for tea or coffee or the soft drinks and all? Maximum of the times we are after those things which are not good for us, because we don't understand ourselves, right? Number one, this is the root. And number one, we don't understand ourselves. And secondly, we keep on threatening ourselves with death. We keep on threatening ourselves with death. What is it like we always keep on endangering ourselves? What does it mean? Whatever we are having, possessing or pursuing, they are all some way or the other disastrous for us. Maybe the mobile, maybe the tea, maybe the soft drinks, maybe the burgers, maybe the pizzas, whatever. Okay. So all those fats, all those things with maximum cholesterol and all, they are our hot favorites. Okay. So we don't understand ourselves and we keep on threatening ourselves with death. Because of this, we are getting ourselves degraded day by day. And the poet says that we should not let it happen. And that is all because why it is also happening. We don't understand ourselves. We are not, I've taken these lines from the poem. These are the root causes of our degradation. Now the point is like, why are we doing like this also? Because we are single-minded. Why I'm saying single-minded? See the line. Life is what it is about. He says, if we were not so single-minded about keeping our lives moving, if we were not so single-minded, single-mindedly, without thinking, we are moving ahead. With single-mindedly, without focus, we are moving ahead. For example, if I talk about a person who is after earning money, if there is a person who just wants to earn money by hook or by crook, day and night he is, you know, busy, doesn't even and says that I don't even have time for my good health, doesn't even go for yoga or for walk or for meditation, he has no time for spirituality. Why? Because he says that I'm very busy. What he is busy with? Busy with collecting death. Why I'm saying this? Because when you'll be after something at the cost of your health, you are blind or we are blind. If I talk about the students, if somebody says, ma'am, I want 100% marks or I want good results, I want to be a doctor or I want to be an engineer or this or that, thereby compromising upon his health, fitness, relations, will he get what he wants? If you're healthy, you can get everything. If you're healthy and if you've got good relations with your parents, with your family, with your teachers, then many of your problems will be sorted out. Relationship doesn't need social networking. Relationship simply means sincerity. Okay? So point is, if you will be single-mindedly after something, thereby compromising with your health, fitness, and relations, no use. So the poet says, if we were not so single-minded about keeping our lives moving, then perhaps we would be saved. Means we don't have to be blind in getting something. Good, you have to earn money. Good, but take care of your health also. Take care of your relations also. Take care of your spirituality also. Then you can get whatever you want. If you are studying, if you want good results, take care of your health, take care of your relations, take care of your spirituality. Why is spirituality I'm emphasizing? Because spirituality makes us strong from within. Good food will make us strong from outside. Our body will be fit. But unless and until our mind is healthy, we won't be able to do anything. And mind becomes healthy with spirituality. And spirituality is not just about religion. Spirituality is about meditation. Meditation, you just close your eyes and the moment you'll be talking with yourself, you will be talking with God. God is what? Somebody who is within you. Something which is within you. God is not outside. God is within us. Okay? So spirituality strengthens us. And spirituality is all about meditation, nothing else. Okay, remember, religion makes us narrow-minded. Spirituality makes us one with the whole universe. Remember? So the first and foremost thing to be on the prosperous path is to be one with ourselves. My mind, my body, and my soul, they are three in one. But with whatever we are doing, we are divided into three parts. I am divided into three parts. If on one side I have my social networking side, and on other side my professional life, and on other side my all stress, my burdens, my assignments, then I'll be divided into three parts. And with my divided self, I will not be able to do anything. So I have to be three in one. And that is with fitness, okay, good health. Health, you know, food, exercises, yoga, meditation. Meditation or spirituality is one thing. Third is relations. Have good and happy relations with your all, with your friends, with your family, with your teachers. But teenagers think like if you have good relations with your friends, so everything is fine. Parents ko to puchta hi nahi hai koi, teachers ko to waise hi kahin koi naam hi nahi hai, right? So only friends are not enough, because they are your age mates. Others also matter. Okay, sometimes go and talk to your very old grandmother. Sometimes go and talk to your very old grandfather, your nanu or dadu, whosoever. Talk to them sometimes. You will see like you've got the wealth of the world. Okay, sometimes go and talk to your very busy father. You'll get to know like, oh my God, my father is so tensed. I never knew this. Sometimes go and talk to your mother about what she is doing in the kitchen. You always get the plate full and you tell 100 things like, it's not that, it's not that. Sometimes go and see and talk to her in the kitchen. Okay, have good relations. Sometimes talk to your small brother, your younger sister or younger brother. You'll get to have a wealth of the world. Instead of chatting with your friends who lives in America, talk to your small brother, younger sister, or elder brother, or elder sister, whosoever you have. Instead of getting interactive with the one who lives in Canada, be interactive with the one who lives in the same house. Okay? It will make you wealthy. It will make you happy, healthy, and wealthy. Happy, healthy, and wealthy. Everything you'll have. And then you study. You'll see, wow, it's so enjoyable. I've never read this kind of poem in my life. I've never read this kind of physics. Physics is so lively. Maths, oh my God, it's too good. That feeling will come when you will have the things all fixed. Right? Okay, now let's see the poem from beginning. The poet says, now we'll count up to 12 and we will all keep still. The poet starts by telling the readers to be quiet. We will all count up to 12 and we will all be still. So he says that let us start the practice of quietitude. Okay, still means when you are, he wants everyone to be still plus quiet. He says, I'll count up to 12 and then we will be still, we won't move, and then we will be quiet. Okay, stillness and quietitude will lead to thinking. So thinking is to be done. It's not that you become still and quiet. This is what happens in the class. The moment we tell small children in first standard, second standard, third standard, we tell them, okay, beta, become quiet. Don't move. After 5 minutes, they go to sleep. And I won't be surprised if the same thing happens with you people also. Because we are active, so far our body is moving. The moment our body is not moving, the moment we are not twittering, we are sleeping otherwise. Because thinking stands nowhere. And thinking is the root of all progress. If Einstein became Einstein, that is because he thought. Whosoever became great, if Shakespeare is Shakespeare because of his thoughts. Talk about any great person. Think about any great person. Is there anyone who became great because he spoke or because he moved? You will tell me, ma'am, yes, dancers are there, singers are there, but they become dancers because they have some moves in their mind. Singers are there because they have some compositions in their mind. Okay, unless and until they remember the notes, they cannot sing. Okay, so chatterboxes never become anything. So there is a difference between being a chatterbox and a person who speaks. Sandeep Maheshwari also speaks. He only speaks and speaks and speaks. But from where do those words come? From here. They are the pearls of wisdom. And wisdom is something within you. In order to give one, discourse by that kind of person, he needs to meditate for about, 1 to 2 hours. He might be meditating throughout the day then. So he says, let me count up to 12 and then we will be all quiet. So the significance of 12, why the poet says only 12, why not 13, why not 14, why not 10, why not 11? Because there are 12 months in a year. There are 12 hours in a clock. 12 is a very significant number or numeral, keeping in mind the time. From the point of time, 12 is very significant. 12 months, 12 hours on a clock. So he says, let me count up to 12 and then we'll all be still. For once on the face of the earth, let's not speak in any language. So the second thing, first he says, we'll be still. We won't move physically. And secondly, we will not speak in any language. And for once on the face of the earth. What is on the face of the earth? What is on the face of the earth means whosoever lives on this planet, whosoever lives here, no one will speak in any language. It's not that Indians will speak in Hindi or in Punjabi and Pakistanis will speak in Urdu. No, we won't speak in any language, no language. Why language word he uses? Because languages or the words are the roots of dispute. If you people have to fight, then we can fight with what? Words. There won't be any fight if we are all quiet. If you all become quiet like this, there won't be any fight. Okay, even if I instigate you, even then you will say, leave it. You won't mind because you will see, mujhe bolna to kuch hai nahi. Why will I, waste my energy? So the disputes, all disputes in this world are because of the languages. So the poet says, let's not speak in any language. Let's stop for 1 second and not move our arms so much. Let us stop for 1 second means let us suspend all activities. Let's not do anything. Let's stop for 1 second means, Bhavya, let's stop for 1 second. Means let us stop doing everything for some time. Let's not do anything. Not even opening the notebook. Not even closing the lid of the pen. Let's stop doing everything for a few minutes and not move our arms so much. Moving arms means not moving physically. Let's not move at all. Not even move arm up and down. Let us become absolutely still. Let us become absolutely quiet. Then he says, what I am saying, let us start the exercise of quietitude. And what is quietitude? Meditation. So let us meditate. And meditation is what? When you're thinking about what you are to do, what you do or not to do, that is introspection. So actually the poet is asking us to go for analysis, that is introspection. The poet is asking us to go for self introspection. And how to go for self introspection? Number one, becoming still. Number two, becoming quiet. Number three, by thinking. Yes, these are the three preconditions to go for self introspection. Okay, tomorrow, children, will be the test of this very poem. As many stanzas we do, the test will be of that much of poem. Okay, and even the test of the previous chapter which we finished, what was that? An elementary school classroom in a slum. The test of the previous poem and even this one, right? Wait.